Good morning, everyone. If you could just take your seats, we'd like to get started. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Greater Toronto Hockey League's summit, which we are calling the Transition Game. And the key word here is, of course, transition. Today, we're going to be talking about a lot of different things: sport, culture, and of course the game of hockey, which I think you all would agree are in transition right now. My name is Brenda Irving. I'm a reporter and producer at CBC Sports. The last few years, I guess you could say I've specialized in our coverage of the Olympic Games. Before we go any further, though, I wanted to acknowledge where this summit is being held today. As many of you know, we are on the traditional territory of several Aboriginal groups, the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, Mississaugas of the Credit, the Chippewa, and the Wendat people. So we would like to thank them for being our host today. Besides being a sports journalist at CBC, I'm also the mother to a son who has played in the GTHL and still continues to play hockey. And as a family, we've experienced so many positive things from playing hockey, but we've also been witness to some of the challenges that the league faces. And I think that's what we're trying to get at the root of today and come up with some solutions to make the game in the Toronto area even better than it is today. Now, there's a couple people you're going to be seeing a lot of today. I wanted to introduce them, Aicta Bromley and John Miller. So if you can just tell us a little bit more about your role and what you're going to be doing today.
Hi, I'm John Miller. I'm president of ICA Associates. It's a training and consulting firm. We specialize in designing and leading participatory processes. So today you're going to see a fair bit of my colleague Aicta Bromley, and tomorrow you'll see a little bit more of me, for those of you who are sticking around to help make plans. Anything else? Our colleagues over here, as you can see, Pam Hubbard and Tanya Gerber are professional graphic recorders. So what they're trying to do throughout the day is to capture people's wisdom and ideas, the sort of kernel of what they're saying, so that you have an additional layer of insight as opposed to just sound going in your ears. Maybe being captured on a video, you'll also have a visual record of the speeches and conversations today. So that's quite a gift over there. And so I'm going to hand it over to Aicta to introduce the next piece, please.
Thanks, Brenda. Thanks, John. I'm going to move over to the front here. And actually, may I ask you for the clicker?
Yes, you can have the clicker.
Thank you. I'm actually going to just kind of be around here. All right. Hello and welcome, everyone. Hi. That's more like it, the transition game. Welcome. So I'm Aicta Bromley. As John already mentioned, we're here today through ICA Associates, which is a training and consulting firm. My background is in the field of organizational development, which is really just another way of saying I work a lot and talk a lot about processes, systems change, culture change. But any which way you slice and dice it, it all comes down to the people. And that's why you're all here today. And so as the people who have chosen to participate here today, because I'm assuming you want to make a positive difference to the culture of youth sport and hockey in particular, my job as the facilitator for today will be to make sure that I guide the process in a way that allows for you to do that, while also having a little bit of fun, just a little bit, and hopefully feeling like you had a very productive day at the end of it all. But all of that really and truly begins with you getting to know who's at your tables, because you're going to be talking and interacting quite a bit as the day goes on today. So without further ado, I'm going to invite everyone. You've probably said your hi, good morning, I am, etc. already, but if you haven't had a chance to do so, let's take about 5 minutes for you to take turns going around your table, and here's what I'm hoping that you'll take turns sharing. So of course your name, But maybe you could give a brief one-line summary of your area of expertise and or your interest, your background. What is it about you that brought you here today? What is it about you that you're hoping to contribute today? So this will have to be quick and snappy because we are on a time limit. So just about maybe under a minute per person. I'll bring us back in about 5 minutes from now. Take it away. All right, folks, I'm going to bring your attention back for one moment. So this is the point at which probably some of you got through your round table. Some of you were about halfway there. You're like, drat, why is she bringing me back? I didn't get my chance to go. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to keep building on those conversation opportunities. We're going to take it a little deeper and go at it a slightly different way this time. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to do paired interviews, recognizing some tables might have odd numbers, so you might have to have pairs and or trios. I'll leave that up to you to self-regulate. But I'm hoping you'll take the next, let's say about 4 to 5 minutes or so, taking turns talking in your pairs or trios and building on what you were saying in your introductions. You can choose to answer either or both of these questions. So what's one key hope that you have from the time that you're going to be spending today? And as you situate yourself in this youth sport and or specific to youth hockey ecosystem, what are some resources, skills, knowledge, experience that you personally are bringing to this topic today? All right, so again, you can choose to answer either or both. Just keeping in mind that each individual probably really only has about a minute or two, making sure that both or all three of you in your set has a chance to go. Please and thank you, and I'll bring us back in about 5 minutes. Take it away. All right, I'm going to bring us back again. I hate to break up the party, folks, but I'm going to bring us back again. Third time's usually the charm. Once I've said it the third time, everyone's like, all right, she really means it. I knew I should have brought one of my giant gongs for today. All righty, so welcome back. Thank you for all that energy and conversation. And again, I apologize if I have interrupted a flow somewhere. I'm sure there's got to be some of that going on. Some of you are a little pissed at me right now. I apologize, but not really, because I got to keep us moving along. So there's going to be lots more opportunities for you to keep talking about all of this and more. But before we continue, I wanted to pause here for a second and give you a quick view of kind of the underlying concept on which the summit and this process is built, so that you can situate yourself in this journey a little bit as you join it today. So we are basing this on an underlying design concept called the 4D planning process. And just in a quick nutshell, there's a couple slides here. This is slide number one. This is just going to tell us about what happens at each stage. So the first stage is define, which is necessary to define the context within which we will have discussions. A lot of that has been done through events leading up to today, which I'm not going to get into because you're going to hear from GTHL speakers soon that will tell you about that. What we're here to do today is this. We are here to dream about what could be, and we're going to be using certain lenses to do that, to kind of frame our conversations, but more on that as the day goes on. What's going to happen from the outputs of today is that we have a little bit of a foundation to design the future direction and commitments, and that leads to a bit of an ongoing delivery of the destiny, the new, refined, rejuvenated destiny of the Greater Toronto Hockey League. So again, a quick glance at when everything happens. So defining the context has been done prior to today. You'll hear more about that. Dreaming happens today. Once we've ended the day, we will have recorded a number of inputs from you in a number of different ways. The design process kicks off tomorrow and carries us forward into the destiny phase for the next few years. So hopefully a lot else has impressed you up to this point with how this has all been put together, but if nothing else, I hope that the word destiny will. Sounds kind of cool, eh? We're all here to kind of reshape destiny. Yes, no, maybe so. All righty. So on that note, I'm going to take us into this last little bit for me for now. You will also find a copy of these participation guidelines in your package. I believe it's the first top sheet in your package. And here's what these are. Our goal here for today is to harvest as much richness from all of the wisdom and experience that we have in the room. So to do that, it's always useful to operate out of certain guidelines and remind ourselves that everyone has wisdom and we need everyone's wisdom for the wisest result. So I'm going to invite you for the rest of the day to periodically check in with yourself and with others at your table to make sure that you are participating and operating out of that paradigm, because the whole picture will come through hearing and understanding all the perspectives that we have in the room here today. And to do that, we will honor the diversity of opinions, listen with attention, and speak with intention. And of course, we will enjoy this special time together, because mandated fun is the best kind, right? And a little housekeeping rule on that note, please refrain from exiting and re-entering the room, of course, as much as you possibly can when there are speeches, presentations, or panel discussions underway. I think this is it for me for now, so I'll hand it back over to Brenda. Thank you.
Well, it was brought to my attention that you're maybe wondering what all these chairs are. It's not for a firing squad. We're going to have panelists up later. We're going to have several speakers and then two panels, one during the morning, one during the afternoon. But it's not for our enjoyment only that we're going to have speakers and panelists, because you can watch this on the World Wide Web if you want. Just go to the GTHL website. So if you have any friends at home that you think may be interested, just tell them to go to the website and press on the links. And they'll probably have better success than I would, because I'm terrible with technology. But yes, so other people can see what we're doing today and listen to some of our speakers. I always knew the GTHL was a big organization, but I didn't really think of the numbers. And let me give you some of those statistics. 40,000 participants, 34,000 kids, more than 80 clubs, thousands of teams, hundreds of referees, and of course, thousands of volunteers. And all organized by a small staff of 15 people, so they have an incredibly hard job to manage all these people and all their needs. And it's all run by the executive director and the chief operating officer, Scott Oakman, and we'd like to hear from him now.
Thank you, Brenda. I didn't realize I did all that. In fact, I don't. I'm very fortunate to have a great group of staff and volunteers that support the work we do on a daily basis. And we do get a lot of things accomplished with a very limited number of resources. So I'm very proud of that. I'm glad to say that we're here. It's been a very long journey, a great journey, and it's only the start of the journey. And we're really excited. This is just going to be an amazing day and a couple of days and start of an amazing process. I want to welcome everybody here today, and I want to thank you very much for spending your time with us today and beyond. I want to welcome any people that have joined us online to stay with us today and provide us your feedback anytime you have some through our office, and we'll be sure to pass that along to the steering committee moving forward. I also want to take the opportunity to thank the steering committee that's been chaired by John Neville. Unbelievable amount of volunteer time that has gone into making this happen today, and the hours of work and emails and more emails and more emails has been unbelievable. So thank you to them for making this happen, and this obviously wouldn't happen without the great support of the sponsors we've had. And I think your packages have a list of those donors and sponsors that have made today possible. So this idea started actually during the 2016 World Cup of Hockey that happened here in Toronto. And during that event, the NHL and NHL Players Association hosted a series of summits, and a number of us were fortunate enough to attend those summits, and out of that came the inspiration for a handful of us to do something more than what we've been doing, and a recognition that we need to be better than we are and more than we are. And those discussions went on for some time, and we kicked around different ideas and different thoughts and what we needed to talk about. In 2019, we conducted a survey of participants, and we had a tremendous response that we'll talk about a little bit later in the program. The committee itself carefully selected the speakers and panelists that you're going to hear today, the participants that are in the room today. We asked organizations to nominate people who would be valuable contributors. We reached out to municipalities, community leaders, educators, and other sport organizations. We wanted to bring together a real cross-section of people to help us create a strategic direction that we needed to make this game better. And we also wanted to come up with strategic directions to help bring children into the game of hockey that aren't currently here. We knocked on doors of sponsors and donors, asking them for their support to make this happen. Each and every one, every door that was answered, those sponsors and donors recognized the importance of the dialogue we wanted to start. Many of them have actually signed up and offered to help support what comes out of these next 2 days as we move forward. In fact, we've had so much support that we've been able to execute the activities today through the summit and tomorrow without the cost of any without any cost being borne by obviously any of you today or the organization as a whole. We've been able to have this whole 2 day event paid for through the gracious support of donors and sponsors, which is tremendous. Tomorrow, a small group of people will take their all the valuable input that's received from you today, and every piece of that input that you have is important to us. And we will put it into our strategies going forward. These strategic pillars will be built on the foundations of your thoughts, ideas, and discussions. After today and tomorrow, the work is just beginning. After tomorrow, we will start on our new destiny. The GTHL will continue to work with the strategists to help us move forward with the agenda established in these 2 days, and we want to involve all of you in that process. We will be reaching out to you, asking for your ongoing support. We will remain in regular contact with you so that you're aware of the progress we are making. You have made an investment in us and in the game of hockey by being here today and spending your valuable time helping us create a path to the future of the game of hockey. We respect your investment. We won't waste it. We value it, and we want you to know your investment will be well spent and it will yield great returns. There's one sponsor in particular and one individual we need to thank. Scotiabank and John Doig continue to show their unwavering commitment to the game of hockey in this country and in particular the GTHL. John is an incredible ambassador for the game of, and on behalf of the GTHL and everyone here today, I want to thank John and invite him up to say a few words. John?
Okay, this is what you came to hear, the banker, right? As a banker, I know no one really wants to hear me, so I promise to be brief and be gone. But I would say a couple of things about hockey. At Scotiabank, we're extremely proud to be supporting hockey. Small towns, big cities, right across the country. It serves us well. I mean, there's a business aspect of that, no question about it. But right across this great country of ours, a couple things are true. Hockey brings Canadians together. Lots of noise in the media lately, questioning those things. I mean, hockey, I think, is a great equalizer. Doesn't matter where you are, doesn't matter what you do. You can get in an elevator with someone and talk about the game last night, right? Anywhere in this country, that works. Doesn't matter if you're the CEO or the fellow parking cars. It's an ultimate equalizer in this country. And I truly believe it brings Canadians together. Our customers tell us that. We spend tens of millions of dollars in hockey space. And we do that, and we can look our shareholders in the eye, and we talk to our board and say, here's what it does for our brand. And the thing that everyone in this room should think about when you spend your next couple of days talking about destiny is everything in hockey in this country starts with minor hockey, right? Everyone we watched last night, the Bruins Leafs game or any other game that you may have watched across the multitude of games that were played, and you can watch them all now, and whatever device you watch them on, every one of those players started in minor hockey. And I would say to you that what you do here is going to be so very important. It's going to be important because what you decide and what you implement is going to impact minor hockey and therefore the country. And you think about that, right? Volunteers in this room, different. What did they say? 80 clubs, right? 80 clubs. Tons and tons of volunteers giving their time. There's a lot of money in hockey too, in minor hockey. Lots of money moving around. It's an expensive sport. We support over 8,000 teams each year in minor hockey. We do that because it helps. We do that because it's good for our brand. What you guys decide and what you implement is going to impact this country, not tomorrow, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years down the road. You have an opportunity to make this game better. And I am super happy that we could be in some way helping that journey. Thank you all for your time.
So, John, just on behalf of the steering committee, I just want to present you with a small token of our appreciation. Thank
awesome,
you.
Awesome, buddy.
Much.
Thank you. Take care.
John, I was we were talking hockey last night, and to me, here's a plug for the bank. Scotiabank has always been hockey to me. I mean, I remember when I am dating myself, 12 years old, 1972 Canada-Russia series, and I went to my mom. I said, I need a bank account. She goes, why? You have no money. And I said, because they have this poster of all the players that are going to go over to Russia, and we can sign these postcards and send them over there. So anyway, I still have that poster, and I still have some of the postcards. Okay, thank you. As a mom, I've always admired those parents that put up their hand and say, you know, I'm going to help. Usually their story goes something like this. They show up at that first training camp or tryout practice, and they see that there's a bit of a leadership void. So they decide to become a manager, a coach, or a trainer. Of course, you know, at the beginning, we've all heard this, oh, I'll just do it this year, just this one year. But then it becomes part of the routine, the winter routine, and they end up doing it for years and years and years. Then, I guess when their son or daughter moves on, they retire from the sport, or they just end up going to university, those parents usually end up, most of them, leaving the sport and taking that time and doing other things with their lives. But that doesn't always happen. There are some that feel there are just more to do in the sport and want to continue on even after their kids no longer play organized hockey. And that's what has kept Don West involved in this organization. He is the president of the GTHL and the man really who has been the driving force behind what we're witnessing today. So here to set up kind of the day and what we're going to be discussing, Don West.
Thank you, Brenda, and good morning, everyone, and welcome to the transition game. My task over the next 15 minutes or so is to give you some background and some data points that might be helpful as you discuss the issues that we're going to address today. So let's get started. First of all, why did we hold this summit, and why did we choose these two particular themes? We started planning this event about 18 months ago, and we decided that the culture of youth sport and its current trend line and the challenge of making sport more welcoming in a rapidly changing, diverse community were really at the heart of everything we do as coaches, sport administrators, and clubs. And so we thought that we could have chosen other issues or added other things to our agenda, but we felt that these two themes really influenced everything else. Now, when we talk about sport culture, we're really talking about the full environment around the game. So that's on the ice, behind the bench, the coaches, in the stands, the parents, the ride home in the car, and on social media. All of these interactions affect a player's and a family's experience. And of course, they apply in all sports, not just hockey. As Scott mentioned, this event today is being supported by many sport organizations and major corporations. And they recognize the importance of the challenge and the opportunity that we here in Greater Toronto have to reduce sport barriers in a diverse population. In organizing this event, it was very important to us that we really have a broad range of views on our two themes. And so from the GTHL, we have players and coaches, parents, referees, and club officials. And we also have leaders from many other sport organizations here today, including basketball, soccer, volleyball, sledge hockey, water polo, cricket, tennis, track and field, taekwondo, water skiing, and through many of the multi-sport organizations represented here, people who are knowledgeable about many, many other sports. And the GTHL hopes that we will learn from you today, but we also hope that the discussions will be relatable to your sport. And as you can see, the other attendees here include community group leaders, educators, government, and of course our speakers and panelists provide great expertise. There's been lots of surveys done over the years about, you know, why do kids play sport? And there's lots of reasons, but in every survey, the number one reason, not surprisingly, is fun and friends. So it's just really, you know, the pure joy of playing sport. So let's have a look now at a video from our friends at Hockey Canada Foundation.
Guys, you're halfway done.
Le hockey m'a donné 23 heures.
It lets me show the boys I'm just as good.
There was one point in my life where I was just like you did.
So those scenes certainly show the excitement and fun of sport. But unfortunately, some of the recent trends show inconvenient truths about participation in sport. There's a continuing drop in Canadian youth sport participation. Only 9% of kids get 60 minutes of physical activity a day. High school students spend on average 8 hours a day on screens. And this one is probably the most concerning. 70% of children drop out of organized sport by the age of 13. Here are Hockey Canada's registrations over the last 10 years. And this is for players ages 5 to 17 and includes both boys and girls. I should just point out, it doesn't show separately the registrations in school hockey and other hockey leagues that are outside the Hockey Canada system. But many of the kids in school programs are also playing on Hockey Canada teams, so their registrations would be reflected here. And this is the sign up and drop out over the last 4 years. And again, players age 5 to 17, boys and girls in Hockey Canada. And this chart shows GTHL registration over 9 years. And it includes A, AA, and AAA, Mississauga Hockey League, which is a division of the GTHL, and House League players. And you can see that there's a smaller percentage decline than the national registrations. But on the other hand, we have to consider population growth in Greater Toronto during this same time period. So this shows population percentage growth 2011 to 2016, which was the date of the last Canadian census, compared to GTHL percentage decline 2011 to 2019. This slide shows the main reasons determined for the withdrawal from youth sports, and it's not, again, from hockey alone. And I'm sure most of the people in the room won't be surprised by those things. As Scott mentioned, in February and March of this year, the GTHL conducted a survey to ask our constituents a number of questions. We had 2,700 responses from players, parents, coaches, club and house league officials, and referees. And there was certainly some good news. 82% of respondents said that hockey had been a positive influence in developing their child's character. 52% said that it had helped their child's performance in school, probably from a time management perspective. And 80% were satisfied with the amount of time that they devoted to hockey. Now the bad news. These are the items I'm going to show you that generated the highest levels of dissatisfaction, and I excluded all the complaints about referees, which of course everybody expects. So, not surprisingly, cost was number one. 52% of our respondents ranked that as first or second in dissatisfaction. The level of respect and civility shown by parents was not too far behind, 41% dissatisfied. Too much emphasis on recruiting, which I would sort of equate to trying to win, compared to development, 40% dissatisfied. And the level of sportsmanship among players, coaches, and referees, 33% were dissatisfied. Those last three items all relate to sport culture. Now, perhaps there's only a relatively small minority of players, coaches, and parents on any team who exhibit really poor conduct, but they impact the overall sport environment. And that conduct gives moral license to the others. Too much yelling at the referees, too much pounding on the glass, and standards drop. And as the adults watch the kids are watching back. So now let's move to the second theme today. The diversity challenge. Inclusiveness of sport and hockey in particular in a community here which has seen such rapid demographic change over the last 20 years. So here are a couple of Stats Canada data points. 51% of residents in Toronto were born outside Canada. And this one is really interesting. 76% of people under the age of 35 are first or second generation immigrants. It's also important, though, to recognize that Canadians support immigration. According to Environics, 77% of Canadians see immigration as economically positive, and only 3% of Canadians see immigration as a problem. Interestingly enough, that's compared to Americans, who are 9 times more likely than Canadians to see immigration as a problem. Toronto is certainly admired for all its diverse communities. It's part of what gives Toronto regular high scores in livability rankings. In 2019, The Economist magazine ranking of 140 cities put Toronto at number 7. However, as we all know, diversity brings economic transition challenges and risks of social detachment, and sport can be a pathway to social cohesion. But there are, of course, barriers, and they're well known, I'm sure, to all of you. And particularly, the culture of sport, or at least the perceived culture, can be a significant barrier to participation. So our two themes today really are interrelated. In addition, although it's not a barrier, sport preferences change as social demographics change. So let's have a look at some video again.
My dad played soccer his whole life. He always told me it's the world game, and now it's my game too.
I love watching the NBA. There's something about it. It's just cool.
We were spending $8,000 a year on hockey. It became too much to handle, so we took him out. There are other sports they enjoy for less.
Hockey players make it look easy, but skating looks hard. I wish it was easier to learn. It doesn't feel natural.
Basketball's simple. Just pick up a ball and go.
We thought hockey was a winter sport, but then there were summer tournaments and dry land training. What happened to playing multiple sports?
Kids and families have lots of sport choices, and we're not seeking to persuade kids to play hockey instead of other sports. We'd like to see kids playing multiple sports. We simply want to make the minor hockey experience and environment better and more accessible to everyone who chooses to play. So, the search for solutions. That Yogi Berra quote is maybe a little harsh. We're not completely lost. Certainly the GTHL, Hockey Canada, and other hockey organizations have made lots of changes and adopted new approaches over the last 5 to 10 years. And they're good steps in the right direction. But in that period, the culture of youth sport and accessibility has probably not improved very much. Let's see what the experts say today. So the question is, can we somehow significantly shift sport culture and draw more kids and families into the game? It's not an easy task. It's going to require innovative thinking. It'll take time and lots of good planning. But here's a sort of a simple question that you might consider as you listen and debate the issues today. So, culture change requires collective voices and collective action. We have a great collective here today. Let's start. Thank you very much.
Well, there are a few sports figures in the city who you could call household names. I guess we think of the John Tavares's, Mitch Marner's, Kyle Lowry's, and Masai Ujiri's of this world. And I think our next guest can be put in that group, Kyle Dubas, the general manager of the Toronto Maple Leafs. His job, it's a tough one, tougher than mine, is to try to bring a Stanley Cup back to the city of Toronto. And he's being asked to do what a dozen, I think, or so general managers before him weren't able to do. And that's a tall order, but it's not Kyle's only job. One of his jobs is to see that all those seats in the Scotiabank Arena are filled for all the home games. And on the surface, you think, ah, that's no problem, because even when they were losing in the past, those seats would be filled. But Kyle doesn't want to take anything like that for granted, because Toronto is changing, as we know, and it's not the same city that it used to be. The GTA is more diverse than ever, that's for sure. Kyle wants his organization to really thrive into the future, and that means expanding the fan base. And that's the reason why he's here today. Welcome, Kyle Dubas.
All right. Thank you very much for having me here today. It really is an honor to be asked to be here. And oftentimes people will say, why do you care about this stuff? Shouldn't you just care about making sure the Maple Leafs are winning games? And I will say that those questions are fewer and fewer and easier to answer when we haven't lost four in a row. But nonetheless, we're here. And I don't think that despite the ups and downs of a season or seasons at a time, we can lose sight of what we're really trying to do. And the reason why I am here is very simple, is that I love hockey. Probably the same reasons why everyone in this room has grown themselves to be here. And when I watch the evolution of hockey, we have a 2.5-year-old son, and I've got the first ever time I was asked the question ever before the meeting was, well, what minor hockey association will he be a part of? And we live in the city, and I'd never really thought that in a year and a half we're going to be undergoing that same decision. And for some reason, our son loves hockey and everything about it, and so it's great and it's easy. But when we look at the sport as an organization, and when we're analyzing what's happening in the sport and how it will influence the Maple Leafs, I think we don't want to look 20 years from now and see that we're having problems drawing fans into our building, or that the next generation of people growing up in our community don't have the same passion for hockey and passion for the Maple Leafs that everybody in the room has. And what I will say is that I've been a part of two organizations in my life, the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds and now the Maple Leafs. And going into both, we were tasked with changing the culture of the organization. And what I've learned in my brief experience in life and in professional hockey is that when you're trying to change a culture, you'll often go through what I think are three stages. And the first is you're going to be ridiculed or laughed at for what you're trying to do. People will mock the plan of what you're attempting to change, and you'll hear things like, well, this is the way we've always done it, this is the way that it's always worked, and therefore why would you want to change it? And then when you just keep marching ahead and sticking with your plan, people will become violently opposed, because they may be part of the old guard that doesn't want to adapt, and they don't want to see people who are doing things differently begin to succeed. And we're not nearly at this point with the Maple Leafs yet, evidently, but the third part, which I experienced in the Sioux, was that different people around the league, or your competitors or your fellow owners or stakeholders or volunteers, begin seeing the change and accepting it as self-evident. And that's really my experience with trying to change cultures. And it was able to be a success in Sault Ste. Marie. It's a work in progress here in Toronto, and we face many different challenges with the Maple Leafs and in trying to get that through. But I have a great deal of respect for everybody in the room and what they do for hockey. And the way that we look at it as an organization is that if people aren't signing up to play hockey, and there aren't owners of organizations or committees that run different groups, then people aren't going to sign up to play hockey. And you're tasked, we're at the top end of it. And so the value that we have for everybody in the room who's come here today is so massive, because you're tasked with cultivating and harvesting passion and love for hockey and dealing and working through a lot of the issues that they just posted on the slide before, which we don't really deal with. But they will be our issue, if not for the work that you will all do and for days like today, which try to set the course to try to continue to improve the game that we all love and love enough that we all come out here on a Saturday morning when we could be doing other things to talk about how we can improve it for generations and generations to come. So that's really what I wanted to impart today. And the final note is, one of the key things that we've done, both in Sault Ste. Marie with the Greyhounds and with the Maple Leafs, is with our modeling of our team and how we take a player in when they first arrive. They've gone through all of your organizations or different organizations from throughout the world, and they've either gone to junior hockey or college hockey and then come to our organization. So they've been touched and pushed along by many great people along the way. But one of the major things that we did when we first came, this is my sixth season with the Leafs, is we altered our development model. And when John and Don approached me about speaking today, one of the key points that I think I can speak on with greater experience, not at the minor hockey level, is on the winning versus development debate. And when we first came to Toronto and to the Maple Leafs, one of the things I was put in charge of in my background from Sault Ste. Marie was in scouting and development. So our development model was one of the elements that was put onto my desk. And the debate all the time in pro hockey, but also at your levels, especially at the AAA level or the AA level, is on recruiting the best players and trying to win your respective league and division. And I think that's great. Those are great experience for children growing up and for the organization, is everybody wants to win. What we've done with our development model is we've shifted our focus away from solely winning, with the mindset that if we put all of our effort into developing each individual player and staff member that comes through our model, that as long as we're finding people and players that have acceptable level of skill, that we will get more out of them, and that if we can better develop those players and those staff members than our competitors in the league, that will contribute to us winning more and more. And so our model has shifted from focusing at the minor league level from purely trying to win and doing everything we can to win, so going out and acquiring more veteran players, so on and so forth, to committing our time and resources to our young players. And when it comes to development, one of the major things that we've done, and I'll speak specifically of the Marlies and the Growlers, which are two development teams that play for us with the Leafs, is we've gone from a practice model where it's simply about tactics every single day of the week. So, for example, the Marlies this week had four practice days. Two of the practice days were solely about individual development of the players. There was nothing to do with tactics. There was nothing to do with getting ready to play the Texas Stars tonight. They were all about individual development, and each player had an individual development plan. And what we found from that is that the players believe that you have a deep level of care for their individual development, and thus they are willing to give more back to the team. And I think that was the major driving force towards the Marlies winning in 2018 and towards a lot of those players that played on those Marlies teams then graduating on to the Maple Leafs. So that's what I can share from mine. I know it's not, we have tremendous resources, we have highly paid coaches, we have all those different things that certainly enable us to do those, but that is the one element of the winning versus development angle that I feel I wanted to share today. So with that, I'll turn it over to any questions that anybody may have. Feel free to fire away. Oh, Brenda, you have some. Okay.
Yeah. Have a seat.
Okay.
Take a mic.
Well, I didn't know I was going on the hot seat.
Okay, here we go. This is the firing squad. I used to work in the Sioux a couple years. Terry Crisp was the coach at the time.
They had great teams.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah. No, it was good.
I wasn't alive yet, but
Terry Crisp.
Sure, hey.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for that. Okay, so your team played Boston last night. Tonight they're in Philadelphia. Pittsburgh. Oh, sorry.
Toronto people Pittsburgh. Are very quick to let you know when you've said something or done something wrong with the hockey
team.
Yeah,
they're right on you, right? They wouldn't do that in the Sioux. Usually you travel with the team, mm-hmm. but you've decided, you know, to stay back and be here for this. And you said a few things when you were speaking, but why is it so important that you be involved with the GTHL at this level?
I think it's just we're here today because it's a GTHL event, but I think it's a minor hockey situation at large, Brenda, is that we can do nothing at the NHL level or with the Leafs and hope that everybody here makes it okay and we fix the issues of enrollment or making sure that we're reaching out to different all swaths of our community and people who are newly immigrated here or who represent different races, et cetera. But we can sit and hope that it fixes itself or that there's no long-term issue. But I think for us to just hope and not support and come and tell everybody how much we appreciate what they do and try to help as much as we can would be ignorant of us. So I do think it's important that we have a role and that we do as much as we can to help everyone.
Well, the perception has always been that, you know, hockey is Canada's game. That's changing. How do you see some of the, there's many ways we can go about this, but what do you see as the best way to get more kids into the game?
Well, people will tell us it's easy, that if the Maple Leafs won a Stanley Cup, it would bring in all these different, it would bring in all...
It's your fault.
Yeah, well, okay. but there is something to that. I think you look at the Raptors and you look at TFC, and they've had, you know, long runs in the last number of seasons, and with that, you gain interest, and people in the community have a sense of civic pride, or in the Raptors' case, the nation, or even in the Blue Jays' case, the nation, they have a sense of massive pride about it, and so they become more interested in their respective sport. The Leafs, I think we have a huge reach in Toronto, but I don't think us going on a long playoff run into May and June will really inspire the youth of Montreal or Vancouver. That said, as Don, the one slide pointed out, the level of diversity in our community and the way that our community is growing gives us a huge opportunity. So we can do a couple of things. Number one, we could reach our goal, which is we would like to win the Stanley Cup, and as many as we possibly can, and we're working towards that every single day, and some days are easier than others, but that's what makes it the journey worthwhile, we feel. And the second part is we have a great part of our organization, which is tasked with community outreach and making sure that we're doing all that we can. And I think we would like to do more, and I'm sure everyone would like us to do more within our community and get proper direction for where we can help, where we can educate people on hockey, where we can draw more people into hockey, and then work with the NHL programs that are in the same vein. I think the one thing is that because we're Toronto, everyone says, well, they don't have an issue with people playing hockey because it's Toronto. And so about a month ago, there was why I became really interested in this topic and then went to the NHL summit on the same light a few weeks ago, was that there was on the front page of the Toronto Star, there was an article, and I'd never really thought of this either because our family loves hockey and you don't think about it this way, that said, you know, we should be eliminating hockey rinks from outdoor hockey rinks and replacing them with basketball courts, cricket pitches, so on and so forth. And it was the first time that I was really thought that we could have not an issue, but a potential issue if we don't do anything about it. And then at the same time, John reached out about this. And so it's very clear that people who are much more in tune have been doing a lot of work on this and are aware of it. And I think without our support, if we just stay above the fray and let everybody else figure it out, I think we would be doing a disservice to the people who care a lot about our team in the community.
I know diversity is important to you. I think you said, you know, if you're only hiring white males, you're probably leaving good people behind. And that's where the more diverse your organization is, the better the organization is. What has increased diversity brought to your club, and what do you think it could mean to this organization?
For us, I think it's whether it's been people of different races, religions, genders, it's just really added to the diversity of thought. People who come from different backgrounds, different experiences, different walks of life and different professions before they join ours have a different way of viewing the problems that impact our organization trying to reach its potential. And those people that that we've added to our organization in the past number of years, regardless of race, sex, et cetera, have allowed us to become much more whole in the way that we think about every issue that, that we're presented with. And it's been a huge benefit to us as we've begun to transition from where we were when we first arrived to where we are now and to where we hope to be going. And the one thing is that that we found is that there, when we have an application process, we don't draw in a lot of diverse candidates for jobs with the Maple Leafs. They're mostly white males. A small percentage are white females, but when we get the applications in, we go through a blind hiring process. But after, I'll always ask, you know, what was the pool of people that applied here? And it's sad to say that I think that's one of the things that impacts us, is that, you know, and I talk to the other members of our organization, whether it's our data labs part, our basketball, our soccer teams, and they don't have the same issue as we do in that regard.
Well, thanks for this, and I'm glad you stayed in town. We appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Good luck tonight. Yeah, okay. Thank you. Take care. There you go. Okay, so another brief overview just of how things are going to work today. This morning, we are going to have two more terrific speakers. Then we'll get 20 minutes each, and we're going to challenge your preconceptions. I get you to think about what the speakers said, and then the real work begins at the table. You're going to share some ideas. We're asking you to take some risks, be innovative, be provocative. You'll have about 20 minutes, and then we're going to gather all those ideas, which is going to be tough to do, and put them forward to a panel discussion that we're going to have. Ekta and John are going to help us do that. We couldn't do it by ourselves. But a reminder that this is not a one-day process. This is a two-day summit. Today is about learning and about generating ideas. Tomorrow, 40 of you are going to return, and you have a tough job. It's going to be to turn those ideas into action. And to be clear, this is not all about talk. It's about gathering ideas and coming up with actionable ideas that we can put into action here in the GTHL. Our next speaker. Most of us in this room have felt the pressure to make our kids do well in sports. And in hockey, it may be extra skating, maybe learn how to get a better slap shot, summer leagues. Maybe you hire a coach, one-on-one coach, to spend with your child. But it seems like we'll do almost anything to make sure our child is the best that they can be, which is admirable. But our next speaker, Dr. Stephen Norris, has worked with Olympians, but he's also worked with players and coaches in minor sport. He is a teacher at Mount Royal University in Calgary and now is with iMobius Ingenuity and here to speak to us about creating a very positive youth hockey experience is Dr. Stephen Norris.
Thank you. Well, good morning. I'm going to deviate a little bit from that singular topic because I believe despite my accent, it's always difficult speaking with my accent around hockey. But I'm one of those immigrants. The only thing is I came here in 1990, so I've been here quite a few years. And since 1995, about September the 5th, I've had the great honor to work with Hockey Canada for the last 20-odd years, specifically around the men's program, the women's program, and the sledge teams at the highest level. I also had the great honor of being the director of sport physiology and strategic planning for the Canadian Winter Olympic teams based in the Calgary-Bow Valley corridor over four Olympic cycles from Salt Lake City all the way through to Sochi. My job description over those periods of time, despite the fact I was several degrees of freedom, of separation away from the actual sharp end of performance, was simply this: Olympic, World Championship, and World Cup titles. End of story. Ruthless. So what I'm going to talk to you about today this landscape of child and youth development, the lead metrics that ultimately result in some final lag metrics, the lag metrics that we're often focused on inappropriately in child and youth sport, as the world I've lived in, those lag metrics. But we neglect at our peril the process to get there. What it takes to become a champion is radically different than what it is to be a champion. And we lose sight of that. The games that we watch on television in the NHL, or in Europe in the KHL, for example, very few players that play hockey play that version of the game. Very few. You know, it consumes us. And we as, I'm sorry, ignorant adults water down that game to our children and youth at our peril. So I'm a friend very much of the GTHL. If the GTHL fails, hockey in Canada will fail. And it arguably already is, but we're focused on the lag metrics and not the important lead metrics. So as a friend, a good friend tells you the truth, but does it in both a passionate way and a dispassionate way. Certainly having the emotion to try to get the argument across, but backing it up with the actual facts. And unfortunately, much like soccer, football in the United Kingdom, emotion rules the roost. Emotion and ignorance. And I caution you this, volunteerism, however much we love them, bedrock of minor sport, of all sports, and many aspects of Canadian society, is not an excuse for underperformance. If you are going to get involved with the activities of children and youth, our most precious resource, despite the fact I live in Alberta and they have a different view of resources, our most precious resource are our 5-year-olds to our 15-year-olds. We have a duty of care and custodial responsibility to do the best thing from them, not us as the adults. We are here to help shape them at the most elastic and plastic time of their lives. So I euphemistically call this WTF, because I am deeply frustrated. I don't know where Team Canada of the future comes from. I see kids appearing at 18, 19 years of age, knocking on the door of a junior team for Canada in various sports, poorly equipped, poor attitudes, poor behavior, poor lifestyle, a modicum of athletic capability, and a modicum, actually, ironically, of sports specificity, despite the hours they put into it, often with a catalogue of injuries that they come to the development table with, all in the meaningless pursuit of another age group trophy. I don't care who wins at 12 or 14 or 16. There is no such thing in the vast majority of sports as an age group champion. Hockey is designed to be at its peak somewhere between 25 and 35 years of age, non-gender specific. We are in a power sport. There may be the odd outlier, teenager, one in several hundred thousand that could actually play at that level. But let's not fool ourselves. Anything until that level is developmental hockey, whether you like it or not. You cannot take a 16-year-old typically and put them straight into the NHL. They will not survive. It's an adult game. Hashtag, their lives, not ours, their lives. That's why we're doing this, surely. Which leads me to this, Coco Chanel's famous quote. In order to be irreplaceable, one must always be different. So do you have the courage, as the GTHL, a pinnacle, a crucible of development for children and youth, to do the right thing and be different and to buck the madness that goes on across many sports? And yet it's kind of interesting in age group sport that we throw out all the rules that we'd expect to see in academia and schools. We understand you take a child and you put them into grade one. The curriculum for the grade one kid is designed for grade oneers. It's taught by someone perfectly capable of understanding and teaching that curriculum, and they use a form of assessment, aka competition, that's appropriate for grade one. And it looks radically different than grade six, and radically different than grade 12. And the exams, aka competition, only really start to get important in about 10, 11, 12. And even then, it's a stepping stone to the rest of their future. We get it, and it takes 12 years. We're not trying to, I don't know, win a grade one. Oh, and by the way, scaling. Scaling, appropriate size of capability of anything. We understand. You go to an elementary school, all the furniture is small. They arrive on small bikes. They wear small clothing. They even get a nap in the afternoon. We understand that. And yet, you talk to the, I'm dealing with some parents. So I'm going up to Northern Ontario next week to North Bay, and I understand the challenges. It's not hockey, according to these people, unless they're playing on a full surface ice, which of course is designed for adults. And you take what is actually a power sport and turn it into a massive endurance sport for these little kids. And worse still, because they don't have the capability, they don't actually touch the puck that much, or maybe one or two do, because they have an ability to perhaps skate a little bit better than their peers at that moment in time, but roll the dice forward another 10 years and the rules have changed quite dramatically. But no one, at least the adults, have the patience to deal with that. None. Now, I believe in giving resources, so I don't expect to get to all my slides. They are a resource for you. I don't normally like putting up loads of graphs and numbers, but for hockey talks, I do. Normally, I just show photographs and talk around them, and they use it as a memory jogger for me to get across the salient points that I want to share with you. And I realize, yes, I perhaps come across as a big-headed SOB, but I am deeply frustrated as your friend. I had a very negative experience a couple of years back in North York when I was told, basically, they had the best six-year-olds on the planet. Well, I'm sorry, that's the reality. But we're not in that game per se. We're in the game of producing eventually the best Canadians. Every one of these kids, age 5 to 20, that we're dealing with right now will be the parents of the future. They will be hopefully the coaches of the future, the officials of the future, the administrators of the future, and if we're lucky, if we give them a good experience, the benefactors back to hockey of the future. That's part of our responsibility. I talk the world over these days on sustainable performance systems, from car manufacturers to toy manufacturers to the military to the sports. Continuity of leadership with a singular purpose. So I ask you, how are you going to stand out from all other sport organizations, all organizations to do with children and youth, and certainly all hockey groups? Are you going to be a true world-leading organization? And remember this, is the inventor of the transistor radio. We must remember that the past is not always behind us, but more often in front of us, blocking our way. What's our purpose as the GTHL? Fundamentally, why do you exist? The title actually is kind of biased, GTHL, League, Competition. Well, I'll be blunt with you, any idiot can design a competition schedule. It takes no technical knowledge to do that. My mum is 88, coming up for 89 years of age. If I told her, you know, you have to flood the ice like this and you've got this number of teams and the games take this long, she could design a competition schedule for you, knowing nothing about the technical aspects of the game. Your metrics that are being quoted to you, fantastic. At least there was something about participation rates. But every other metric that I hear about is to do simply with competition. And it's not that competition is bad, it's absolutely vital. But where are the stats that tell us about the quality of coaching? Where are the stats that tell us about the environment and where kids go on to, not simply the NHL, because in terms of statistics, that's a relatively small number. So purpose, is it participation? Is it performance development? And do you understand what that actually means? I've suggested that you are a performance development organization, despite the fact as you get to the higher levels, performance can look pretty damn good, but it's still not the highest level of hockey. And the ages are not the true performers eventually. They're getting close. Are you trying to win age group trophies? Spending a lot of money for something that gives someone a good feeling for a while. It's interesting listening to the aspect of, I call it the Olympic effect. You saw it with the Raptors, so basketball interest goes up and maybe participation for a while, but unless you actually have the culture to sustain that lift, you follow the Olympic cycle. So Michael Phelps wins a bunch of medals for the Americans. So swimming participation in the 18 months post the games goes through the roof. The Nadia Comaneci from gymnastics, exactly the same. But they don't sustain unless you build something that is sustainable to keep the youngsters coming in, to be the first choice for parents to put their children into that activity. What are those intangible elements that make people have the choice? And surely one of the biggest metrics for you is that the kids that start out with the GTHL, at the very least as they end high school, are they still with you? 10, 12 years later, whatever it might be. Do they come back year after year? And as they move away from their parental influence to their own influence, are they making the choice of their own volition? I want to go back to hockey, mom and dad. I had a great time. And as they exit their relationship with the GTHL as a player, do they look back on that maybe over a decade of time and said, you know what? And these are the two important answers they should tell you. I had a great time and I learned a lot. Regardless of their performance level. Regardless of their performance level. Is it adult entertainment? Well, I'm facetious and I'll tell you, I think for the most part it is. We adults are entertained by watching our little subjects rush around the ice. And if we could, we'd like to move them with like magnetic hockey underneath the table if we could. Certainly think most coaches would like to do that. Go stand on the blue line. Here's the funny thing. What I find quite distracting is the fact that we call guys that game, you see esports, we call all of them nerds and the people that design those games. And yet they're taught one thing that we almost completely forget about for the people that actually play sports, and that is game theory. Every computer scientist learns game theory. But how many of our coaches understand game theory? We are in an invasion sport. They're all roughly the same. We try to invade an opponent's territory and by whatever the mechanism is, score a goal, points, or whatever it may be. And at the same time, then we try to repel or break down the attack coming from the opposition. There is a mathematical capability to this that every computer scientist knows and learns. But what do? We teach very fixed tactics. Go stand on the blue line when this happens. Oh, coach, what happens if that doesn't happen? Oh, don't worry, you go stand on the blue line. And here's the funny thing. As we've moved through this modern era and we've seen things like IQ become obviously very important, and we've seen the growing trend, particularly of understanding emotional intelligence, EI, we move beyond that to adaptability quotient, adaptability intelligence. It's one of the key things that many of the big Fortune 500 companies are starting to look for. People that can adapt and roll with the punches, deal with ever-changing environments. Well, surely, surely, in an open sport such as hockey, that is a trait. But if you've only ever been exposed to what, maybe after about the age of 10, 12, three coaches, four coaches tops, and they each teach you one particular system of play, we narrow the perspective of our players. So when we talk about tactics, what are you teaching? What are you instructing them? What are we doing? Do we teach them to use their brain, or we just give them a menu? Do this. So understand what development means. I'm fed up also on the technical side, the actual skill acquisition side of seeing players, even at the highest level, who have to break out of their stride and go to a glide to make a fine motor skill, because they can't actually do a gross motor skills like skating at full speed, make the shot, make the pass. Or worse still, they can only turn in one direction more effectively than the other. So I'm right-handed, right leg dominated. So I can turn to the inside where the puck is on the inside of my blade very clearly. But because I didn't grow up playing sport, playing hockey and skating, I'm not so good at pushing off my left leg and protecting the puck the other way. You watch the players that are good enough to turn in both directions. These are things they should have learnt. And the coaches should have had the patience to teach these things and give them the opportunity to keep practicing time on task when they were 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 years of age. But of course, if you have very bad practice to game ratios, and kids are often sitting on the bench at games for long periods of time, and they don't really have the puck themselves to practice these things. When do they learn? Do we understand these concepts? Because too often we talk about high-performance sport. Way down the list. Well, everyone starts as a participant. They then become recreationally competitive, and they may continue that stream for life. And then from there, maybe into performance development, they get a bit more serious. And surely you want the kid to start to lead that by their own volition, to have that drive, to have an atmosphere where failure is just part of the process. And after all, you could actually argue, is it failure when a kid doesn't actually execute something that they've never been able to do in the first place? But we as an adult view it as a failure, as a mistake. Well, they're not there yet. So they're doing what they're doing. We have to cajole them through. But we always come to it, child sport, with an adult lens all the time. And our expectations are out of whack. Despite the fact that these children do, and these youth do, amazing things. I talked a little bit about understanding the difference between lead and lag metrics. Let's take a different sport, just quickly to get you to understand this. Let's take a round of golf. Everyone gets focused on the lag metric, the final round score. That's what everyone thinks. But how did their player get to that score? What was the choice of the club on the first tee? Where did the ball get placed? When they get out onto the fairway, did they actually put it into the middle of the fairway or in the deeper rough to the side? Did they actually then make the right approach shot? Did they, on their final approach shot, put it within 12 feet of the hole? Because we know from the stats of the PGA Tour that if the player puts it inside 12 feet of the hole, they're likely only to make one putt. So again, being a true student of the process, understanding the stats, absolutely vital. And you gradually build the picture. We've seen all these stats. I've got to figure what you're looking at is the population size is the top number for each country, the amount of the percentage of the population that lives in an urban environment, as we've seen an increased urbanization of child sport in Canada in particular, and then the global number of players playing in hockey. So this would be a much larger figure than simply just the Hockey Canada figures, but these are age group figures. So us and the Americans, you know, pretty substantial. And yet we see Sweden, a historical powerhouse, much more effective and efficient than us. And then we see a growing nation coming at us hard. And there are others. Germany, and I didn't even mention, obviously, the other powerhouses of Russia and Czech Republic, et cetera, et cetera. We're one of the most inefficient countries in the world. Here's another thing. You know, when I first arrived in Canada, the population of Canadians in the NHL was around 85%, depending on who you read. The last 3 years, we're dipping below 50%. Catastrophic. Now, there's not one reason for this. There are several reasons why this is happening. Growth of the game, the global game, more and more countries. But one of the key things is we're not as good as we think we are, at least by that metric. If we were the board of directors for PepsiCo or Coca-Cola and we took our market share from 85% to 46% in 20-odd years, we would have our sorry asses fired. And we laugh about it. This is because we're focused on the wrong metrics at the time. We're focused on these insular things right in front of us. We don't understand the true process. That front page of the Toronto Star that was mentioned, that should be a wake-up call, a very serious wake-up call. The other thing, you know, every time we produce a Connor McDavid, produce, we didn't produce him. The kid was born. Fortunately, he had a few people to help nurture him along in the process and perhaps some other lucky breaks. But it's a function of the numbers. So I deliberately wanted to show you the effect of numbers. So he's probably in this extremely gifted line, right? He's four standard deviations, one in 100,000, if you look simply at using IQ as a correlate with sport performance, right? I'm not saying you have a high IQ. I'm showing the effect of numbers. We have large numbers. We throw them at the wall. One, we're going to find, possibly, if they still remain in the game, the kid that's four standard deviations above the average, a Connor McDavid, an Austin Matthews, a Sidney Crosby. That tells us nothing about the system. If our numbers keep plummeting, you can understand where we go. We won't be finding those people, certainly not easily, or they may be going into other activities. This just shows you relative age effect. Basically, because we always want to win at a young age, okay, we can basically look at those born January, February, March, the early catchment of the year. They have a distinct advantage on those born October, November, December. And this trend carries through. Because we have the short-term view of winning. What we don't understand, on an average shape of all the kids playing hockey in the GTHL, that our job is to shift the curve to the right. That's the hallmark of a great developmental program, a great school, a great program of education, a great professional development, is to take averagely good people and make them good. Take good people and make them great. Take the exceptional and nurture them through the process. That's the hallmark of good systems. So where are the metrics on that? What's your scouting report really look like? And remember this one, everyone's afraid that if we ask too much of our volunteers, they'll disappear. Well, you're asking the wrong question. You should be asking, do you want to invest in children and youth? Do you want to put time, effort, and money into children and youth? And if you don't, fine. Fine, great, do something else. Because this is what we are about. Do we have world-class coaching in each group? Or at least even think about the concept of being world-leading. You pride yourself on being the largest hockey organization in the world. That's one metric. Just tells you nothing about the quality of that program. Nothing. This might. The people involved with our children are of the highest order, whether they're volunteers or not. And after all, the brand is everyone and everyone is the brand. As soon as they put on your logo or have an association with you, are they living to the values and beliefs of your organization? I'm not going to go through this. Excuse me. I'm not going to go through this either. What does your comprehensive scouting report look like? Everything. Physical, tactical, technical, health and lifestyle, sleep quality. All these elements that really make up aspect. Mike Babcock, interestingly, always talks about this concept. Build the human first, the athlete second, and the hockey player third. In that order of priority, you are in the game of building Canadians, ultimately. Building Canadians for the future. They will go on to be our teachers, our plumbers, our bankers, our physicians, our parents. That's what you're in. And a few of them, if they have the aptitude and the drive, will maybe make it to a professional career in a sport, and perhaps hockey. Understand the difference between early exposure versus specialization, developers who are early, average, and late, and why that might be happening. And then performers. There's a difference between the developers and the performers, people that perform early, and suddenly this is a superstar, but they may be just in that moment of time. The planets have aligned, and they're the best in their age group at this moment. No foregone conclusion. If you look at another sport, because it's not isolated to just hockey, if you look at the conversion from the World Track and Field to Junior Championships, by the way, 19 years and younger, so it's not like 10 or 12, 19, the conversion of the people that win or medal at the World Juniors to the eventual World Championships, 4%. 4%. And that's even at 19 years of age. So understand the game you're in. Hockey Canada have done some amazing work recently showing the benefits of scaling appropriately for kids. And yet, this is such an emotional topic, not based on fact, emotion of adults. Nothing wrong with emotion except when it's misplaced. And we're making decisions for these kids. You want to get better at something, then be engaged much more within that activity, time on task. The data is conclusive. But we argue all the time, well, it's not hockey. Well, really? Tiering. We use tiering for competition, but not for designing a good program. Tiering is a good thing. But it should be around harnessing the greatest of your programs. Rules and officiating. the hardest form of the game should be the game played at the highest level. In other words, the most challenging the game, the most constraining, so that players have to solve the problem. How the hell do I score? How do we as a team score? So the rules really constrain that. So part of the development process, where officials and the rules are part of that, and you gradually, as competency gets better through the age groups, you add more constraints, more challenges, like the offside rule. I don't even know why we have an offside rule before about the age of 12. The kids will work it out. If some kid goes and goals hang on the opposition goal, let's drop a defender back. But surely we're trying to teach all our kids to rush to the net and score. So give them that opportunity, give them that rush. And then eventually, after a while, you say, well, now that you've got this good and you pass, you've got a bit more tactical awareness, we're going to put a rule in that says you can't cross the blue line, okay, into the opposing area until one of two things have happened. Either a player on your team carries the puck in, or the puck has already gone in ahead of all your teammates. Get the idea? And you add rules to make the challenge more demanding and to eventually get to the highest form of the game. But we don't think that way. We water down the adult form to little kids. Kind of silly, really. So we need a disciplined approach. We need to understand the process. You've got to become true students of the process of child and youth development, at least understanding the broad scopes. You don't have to be a specialist. One of the most important things of great organizations is they know what they know, they know what they don't know, but they know someone who does to help them. We have to understand emotional intelligence as adults. We have to understand self-awareness of ourselves, self-regulation, motivation, empathy, and the social skills. We never teach this stuff or help our coaches and instructors, and yet this is the most important list. For children, and although we often talk about the word fun, I want to plant this seed. There is a difference between enjoyment and fun. You can work damn hard and have a very enjoyable experience. You can lose a game and still enjoy the process. We should be working hard to build an enjoyable approach for our kids that is still challenging, because children and youth respond to the challenge. Do we have that appropriately? And ultimately, our goal is to build active, skilled, imaginative, and resourceful and resilient children. Surely that's what we want to do. And as Babcock said, human first, athlete second, hockey player third. Here's my list for you. Is what we're trying to do by the time they get to about 14, 15, 16, 17. If you want to play the modern game of hockey, we keep the puck. This is the Canadian way. Tom Rennie, Paul Carson, Corey McNabb and I have been talking for a number of years about how do we play the game as Canadians. Keep the puck. What a stupid tactic to dump the puck in all the time. You spent all this time getting the puck. You can only score when you've got it. And yet you give it away just because you're tired and you want to change your lines. But if you were more sophisticated as you watch other sports and other teams and the modern game, perhaps you can change your forwards, but your backline forwards, your two defenders and your goalie, have the capability to hold on to the puck while the line changes. It actually opens up far more tactical capability when you do that. But to keep the puck, you need great skill. You need great awareness tactically. So you've got to teach these things. You need to forecheck aggressively all the time. Five forwards, five defensemen always on the ice at the same time. But we don't tend to think that way. We isolate them, forwards, defensemen, goalie. But that's not how you win in an invasion sport. So understand that. Forecheck. And if you want to forecheck, it means you better be very fit. Very fit. Fast decisions, that comes back to, have you got a bunch of robots or do they understand the game? We often talk about read and react, but we don't really do read and react because we don't teach them game theory. And then finally, back up by goaltending. That should be our checklist for us here in Canada. This is how we play the game. My final points for you, the GTH alumni. This is actually one of your greatest resources, this group of people. They're out there. Now, there's the few we might concentrate on, those that play at the highest level of the professional game currently or in the past. Good, I'm very happy for them. You can use them as banners, you can use them as lightning rods. But what about the expertise from strategic planning consultants through to bankers, to the plumbers, to everyone? You often have problems with fundraising, yet you've got all the skill sets. to solve that problem in your alumni, but you never really tap into them. Why can't I have a card? I'm a card member, alumni of the GTHL. I stopped playing at 18. I just play a little bit recreationally, but I'm still an alumni of this amazing organization. Use them. It's one of your greatest resources. So thank you very much for listening. I hope I've stirred some debate. Thank you.
Stephen, you don't nibble around the edges. Thanks for the blunt talk. Powerful speech. And if I am correct, and you can correct me, Stephen, you're going to be hanging around for today and tomorrow. So if you have any questions, feel free to go up to Stephen. He's very approachable. I'm sure he'd love to talk to you. Now we all have to lean forward, roll up our sleeves, and to help with that, we go back to Ekta and to John. Oh, yes, sorry.
That's okay. Thank you. All right, so as Brenda told us before we heard from Stephen, we're going to follow a bit of a process after each speaker. Side note, if you haven't already, in your red bags, there's a participant package in which there's an agenda. And I'm bringing this to your attention right now to remind you or inform you, if it's your first time hearing this, that there's going to be two speakers this morning, of which Stephen was the first, and then two speakers this afternoon. So the process I'm about to explain to you is what will apply after each of those four rounds. But because this is our first one, I'm just going to take a minute here and give us an overview of how this all works. So first point, as you see, each table needs to appoint four roles. I'll get into some more details about those roles as I go through the rest of the slide. But basically, it's a timekeeper, a recorder, and two keepers of sheets. And those will become clearer, again, as I take us through the rest of the process. So here's what happens. We have a speaker. The speaker talks for about 15 to 20 minutes. After that, we go into a table discussion, which is what we're going to go into next. For each discussion, there's going to be about two or three questions projected on the slide here related to that speaker's focus area. So you're going to take about 15 minutes or so for that kind of broader-based discussion around those two to three questions. The scribe will be kind of taking notes of key points that emerge through those discussions. Then we funnel into what we're going to call a bit of a more final harvest. So that's where, of those two to three questions, we funnel down into one specific area, and you'll spend maybe another 5 to 10 minutes kind of refining your thoughts, funneling through that one more final lens. And that will be what we will call your harvest theme. All right, so your harvest theme, once you've decided on it and your scribe is ready to go, goes on the yellow post-it at your tables in the middle where you have the set of notepads and pens. You'll notice under the notepads you have yellow post-its. So those are for the themes. Here's the second and last thing you're doing at the end of the harvest is you're deciding on a question that's percolating for you as you've been talking through the discussion that you would like to ask the panelists later on. That question, one per table again, goes on the pink post-it. All right, so again, yellow for your harvest themes, pink for your questions. The question again to the panelist, a little note about that, is more just about that topic, not necessarily, you don't have to funnel it as this is for this panelist per se. You do have panelist bios in your package for those that would like to acquaint themselves as well. Alrighty, so this is where, back to the roles, timekeeper, keeping you on track. So discussion about 15 minutes. Set your device, go, when I say go in a minute. Scribe, taking notes throughout. Keeper of the harvest theme sheet is the person guarding the yellow post-it. Keeper of the panel question sheet is the person guarding the pink post-it. And by guarding, I mean holding on to it, because as we get to the end of the time, we'll be coming around to pick them up from the tables. All right? So yellow to one person, pink to the other. Clear as mud? All right, just a couple quick points before I let you take this away. The discussions are obviously meant to be brisk. This is more about just kind of gathering information rather than about trying to get to agreement or I guess engaging in kind of lengthy discourse, et cetera. And feel free to rotate your table roles through the day. I'll leave that up to you or just stick with the same four people as you go through. All right, so with all of that, here's discussion round number one. So here are the 2 to 3 question areas you're going to start off with for about, let's say, 10 minutes. Let's see how that goes. And then the timekeeper will tell you to move on to the harvest stage. And as well, me up here will move us on to the next slide so you know it's time to move on to the harvest where you'll start focusing in a little bit more. All right, take it away.